Ladies and gentlemen, dear delegates, we now move on to the last session before lunch, and this promises to be equally good. This is on legal and ethical issues in disruptive technologies, something of a session that is so close to our hearts. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of intense discussions, a lot of questions, more questions than answers. So in this outlandish information superhighway and in this age of disruptive technologies, we try to put through a very, very good session, very interactive session, which promises to be, though. Can I call the following dignitaries on stage, please? Can I have Rakhi on stage, please? Ms. Rakhi Jindal, Senior Vice President, Operations and Technology and IP Law Group at Citi. Coincidentally, she is also the co-chair of this conference. One round of applause for the wonderful co-chairs, please. Rakhi and Aditi have been able to put up a very impressive program and harness some of the best law talents in the country for this conference. So Rakhi on stage should be joined in by Ms. Kavitha Babu, Director and Commercial Attorney, Microsoft India. Thanks, Kavitha, for joining us once again this year. Can I also have Supratim? Supratim Chakraborty, thank you, Supratim, for your support, associate partner at Khaitan and Company. Mr. Blake Brannon, thank you, OneTrust, for supporting this conference. May I have Mr. Blake on stage, please, Vice President Products at OneTrust. Can I also have Mr. Sivaram Nair, Executive Vice President, Company Secretary and General Counsel, and the Ethics Officer at Mphasis. Thank you, Sivaram. Kanchan, we must have you back on stage. Kanchan Paralkar, Legal and Governance Officer at Tata Insights and Quants. It's part of the Tata Industries Group. And we have N.S. Nappinai. Nappinai, leading advocate and author of Technology Laws Decoded. I feel very privileged because there are so many lawyers I've been working with for the last 13 to 14 years. I know whom to fall back on when I'm in trouble. So Nappinai is one of those lawyers, hopefully. Before we start this panel, the keynoter got a memento, a book called The Technology Laws Decoded, and Nappinai is the author of this wonderful, big, fat book. Why don't you spend a minute with the audience and tell them more about the book, and then we can start the session. Yeah, just a minute.
Thank you, Devi, for such a lovely introduction. And we have a very large panel today. So if possible, I'm going to take even less than a minute to talk about the book. I can just say that, you know, today's topics and discussions that have been put together is a reflection of a lot from what I've written in the book also. It's a beautiful combination of topics. But most significantly, if you see the thread that runs through the sessions through the day, there is a interplay between multiple subjects which we may not even have linked together. This is one instance, this current panel, and the next one where we are discussing about antitrust and privacy. So in effect, what the book talks about, and I am going to capture it in just a couple of lines from the book itself. I hurriedly put it together when Devi sprung this on me. The book starts off with these words: law in the world of the internet is a constantly changing and evolving beast. It neither has parental guidance nor memory genes to guide its path to the lighter horizon. I was a turtle walker, so you know, for me, the lighter horizon to which the turtles move was a very important concept which I've tried to bring here. I've explored in the book every aspect that I have dealt with over the last 17 years of teaching and practicing in this field, of not just cyber laws as a standalone subject, but as an interplay between multiple topics. So this book ranges from its, you know, a foray into technology and the way the Constitution has been reinterpreted to meet this challenge. Of course, the evolving field of cyber crimes, IPR and technology as a completely different field as opposed to just pure IPR or intellectual property rights. And of course, the field of contracts. I think a lot of it was discussed in the last session. A very important point was brought up about the conduct or result, which I would like to address during the panel, because I don't want to take up too much time at this juncture. But that's been dealt with. I've also talked about the broken windows in cyberspace because I firmly believe that whatever we may discuss over here, whatever the laws or policies or regulations, including self-regulation that companies may put in place, unless these are implemented, unless there is enforcement of these rules or laws or guidelines, it's not going to be effective. So this is the concept that I have explored in the last chapter. So with this and with these words, I would like to hand over back to Rakhi. The world of the internet has been, you know, looked at as something which has been born without any kind of restraint. It's a world which has grown exponentially without restraint. And in I've drawn from Chomsky's utopian concept of liberty there, a space where intelligence, dignity, and human happiness can develop and grow without the restraints imposed by formal liberty, which is conceded, measured out, and regulated by the state. Cyberspace was not Chomsky's eternal lie representing the privilege of some founded on the slavery of the rest. Today, and probably a lot during this session, we are likely to discuss about the slavery which we have subjected ourselves to with our dependence on this domain. But with the benefits come a lot of strings. Let's move on to discuss more about the strings that are attached, particularly with respect to privacy. Thank you all, and thank you, Devi, for this opportunity.
Thanks, Nappinai. To start the session, our session today is on the legal and ethical issues in disruptive technologies. That is a very wide and a very interesting topic, sometimes relegated to the background. But history is witness to the fact that whenever we've had anything disruptive, starting from the Industrial Revolution, which mechanized labor, down to our foray into space, the final frontier, it has always benefited humanity. Our knowledge has increased by leaps and bounds. Physical labor has decreased, which has presumably advanced the quality of our lives. But on the flip side, as with any good thing, there is always a looming shadow, a looming darkness. There are fears that disruptive technologies and the way that technology is, you know, improving day by day, it could lead to some very real concerns, such as, you know, do we ascribe the same humanity and the same morals to machines? When with all the advances in medical technology and in gene mapping, are we trying to emulate God? And most importantly for our conference today, with all the division between our private life and our public life is slowly eroding, so are we becoming less private? Is our privacy being less respected? And what have you. So with this background, we have a very professional and a very experienced panel with us. And we will try and deal with as many technologies and processes as possible, but I don't think we have enough time. So we will deal with some of the key processes and technologies, and we leave and we'll open the house for questions. I will start immediately with the questions. First question again is for Nappinai. On artificial intelligence, you know, as you mentioned, AI is everywhere. We have voice recognition, we have driverless cars, we have everything to do with AI now. Traditionally, if software did not work, we would pin liability on the software developer, or we would pin liability on user negligence. But AI is more dynamic, and it depends on machine learning to a large extent, which is uncontrollable. So are we, is law able to keep up with the advances that AI is making?
Very, very interesting question. Thank you, Rakhi, for that. Again, I would like to draw a little bit from my book on this. I have rephrased Thoreau to adapted to technology. And this line I felt really answers the question bang on. Technology may be propelling us into a new century with no plan, no control, no brakes. And I have just cautioned in the book to say that probably it's now time for us to reprise control before we cross the fail-safe point. So, you know, from a lot of these Hindi movies, you can remember this car which is hurtling down towards that precipice. We are almost there. But like you rightly said, technology is also something that you need to embrace. You can't possibly run away from the benefits that it gives. It's very interesting with respect to automation and AI, which is where it has had its maximum exposure globally. Where the laws or regulations are moving is in trying to distinguish one between learning and self-learning. So what they talk about is artificial intelligence, which has been implemented in a system, an automated system, before it is sold to the user. So there, a lot of AI has already developed. It has learned, and up to that point of learning is implemented already. So the manufacturer has some control over the process. Self-learning is the continuation of that learning beyond that implementation. Now the difficulty, and it's very interesting, Germany has conducted a research on this, and they have discussed about how when a car, for instance, is sold to a customer, the assumption is that every Tesla car would remain the same. You know, but with artificial intelligence, what effectively happens is a car is sold at a stage where it is uniform, but then with artificial intelligence, depending on the driver's ability, the user's interface, and their effective usage of the technology, the learning parameters will differ. So the same product becomes a different product for different people in no time. So in effect, what they're trying to say is to say that it may be too premature to put in self-learning AI beyond the sale, but you use AI up to the point of sale. So this is one of the aspects that has been explored. Again, it's an open-ended issue. Considering the kind of things that we have seen when we talk about automation and AI, and I will just give a few examples to just get the thought processes going. Of course, we have the cases of cars crashing, cars burning away, 2014 to 16 to even recently, Tesla included, have had their mishaps. One instance which always comes to my mind when we talk about AI is of the Boeing airliner, which said that, you know, we talk about software and we say that there is no software which can run without bugs. Now, the Boeing airliner had a very strange bug, which a Dreamliner, sorry, had a very strange bug which said that if you have not switched it off and switched it on after some 285 days or something of use or hours of use, it will automatically shut down. So the whole issue became about how the AI is going to just shut your flight down and you don't even know when it's going to happen.
Thank you for your views. Moving on to Sivaram, a point on robotics. Advanced robotics promises a world where there is less physical labor, and it promises a world with better quality of life for possibly marginalized people, where we can have exoskeletons which help physically challenged people move around. What are the ethical issues that you're facing or that the industry is looking at in the space of robotics?
Correct. Yeah, the advantages which you said on robots, it's very clearly evident, right? Lesser time, lesser cost, quality consistency, higher productivity. There are many challenges from the ethical side. Let us take some of them. One is disparity in wealth. We are seeing it, right? Robots replacing people, and usually the lower strata people, and the governments have to be attending to the economic, socio-economic impact which creates. Even in the IT industry, you would have seen, now we talk about forming unions, going to the courts. Earlier, they were the king, now it has completely changed. Automation, no replacing employees. The second one is very interesting, which is disuse atrophy. What happens when you don't use your muscles? If robots, as you said, does robots do everything what human beings done, you will lose your physical activity, mental activity. The result can only be more Alzheimer's, more depression, nothing else. Okay, the third is impact on global warming. Abundance of everything at cheaper costs will surely lead to a aggravated global warming. Robert self-learning, which is very dangerous, right? What we saw, the machine learning taking it to the next level. We had last year, the judge was a robot in a beauty context. And what happened? There was a clear bias against dark-skinned women. They went back to the criteria didn't put anything of that sort. Now they are saying that the coder would have had some personal bias, not explicitly written, and the machine takes it to the next level. Very dangerous. Facebook had, if you know, a new language coming, they had to shut down immediately, which was so unintended consequences, undesirable, very dangerous. Morality in decision making. Now that, Nappinai, as you were saying, in a driverless car, right? Suddenly five children come in front of the car and one passenger inside. Would the car save the passenger or the children? But interestingly, a month back or something, there was a test done on one of the driverless car, and the situation is, there is a motorbike, there is a bigger vehicle, and the car has to be hitting one of them. It was found that the car went and hit the motorbike, which means it's always trying to save the passenger inside, thinking that he's the owner. So all these ethical things needs to be taken care of. And the last one is the threat of being hacked, right? If everything becomes digital, coded, there can be somebody who can misuse it by running an algorithm, no, which can, which would not give, like a driverless car. You want to go to X place, it will go to Y place, and you can, consequences can be different. So all that. I think I would stop over here. There would be many more unintended consequence on this.
Thanks, Sivaram, for that snapshot of the ethical issues. Coming to Kavitha on cloud computing, the whole premise of cloud computing is that the data is not stored locally and it's stored in the cloud. And it's there are a number of service providers who may be involved when we talk about cloud computing. This results in a situation where the user does not have control over the data. The user does not even know what sort of privacy philosophies and policies the various service providers in the ecosystem follow. And this sometimes results in customers saying, you know, we don't really trust the cloud. So have you seen that in the industry? And what is it that the industry is doing to allay these fears?
So the father of quantum physics, Niels Bohr, said that predicting is difficult, especially about the future, right? But one thing's for sure, and if you have to believe the Gartners of the world, cloud computing is here to stay. It has been for a while, but it's here to stay, and every business of the future is going to be a digital business. In fact, there is statistics to show that 90% of the apps or solutions that will be developed by the end of 2018 is going to be natively built on the cloud. So it's just, it's not a matter of when it is happening around us, right? But you still raise very, very valid questions, because the environment that this technology subsists in is complicated, especially from a regulatory standpoint. You have laws around privacy and security that are changing dynamically. Positions that have long been held can be, you know, written away by a pen stroke. And the example of that is what happened with the safe harbor provisions between US and Europe. And you have new laws, complex laws, and that are, you know, being implemented, GDPR, for example, laws that are yet to be implemented as an outcome of the, you know, Supreme Court judgment here in India. It is a complex landscape, and when you're running a global business, all of these intersect and make it even more difficult for people in this room, which I'm assuming most of you are lawyers, for, you know, to do your jobs. But the fact is that you have to, I mean, you're expected to be experts on privacy, and you're expected to also be able to advise your boards about risk-taking, etc. So there are questions that you need to ask your cloud service, you know, when you're using solutions that are based in the cloud. there may be applications that may be resident on your premises. I mean, they may be, you know, in your premises and you think that you have control over it, but they may also be built on infrastructure that is based in the cloud. And so it just, you know, when you're trying to pin or when you're trying to find one throat to choke, it can be a challenge from a customer standpoint, right? So it's really, really important to understand what are the right questions that need to be asked. There is a responsibility, therefore, as an industry, to make sure that we have standards that are dependable from a privacy standpoint. And there are well-established international standards that are developed on privacy in the cloud in the form of ISO 27018 that define some very stringent set of extremely, like, you know, there are almost 1600 plus controls in the standard. And so the hope is that when this, in the absence of laws, if this, the industry actually self-regulates itself against these, you know, very, very compelling stringent standards, we will create an ecosystem where the expectations from the customer are high, and that every player, if he has to be relevant in the cloud industry, will have to sort of answer to those controls as well. So the answer, I mean, as lawyers, we tend to sort of really limit our conversations to, you know, limitation of liability. Can I, you know, who will indemnify me when things go wrong? I think it's time to sort of elevate that conversation and elevate that discourse. It's important sort of to recognize that there are multiplicity of players and be able to also identify what the responsibility of each of those players are. And that could be a combination of, you know, applications, you know, providers, the cloud infrastructure providers, and you as a user yourself. There are responsibilities around privacy and security and controls that reside at each one of these levels. And so it is, we're all in this marriage together. And, you know, just pushing the, you know, buck from one to another is just not the way to address it. But at the same time, holding every player, in every cloud technology provider responsible for what they say that they are going to do, not only in terms of expecting them to share, say, you know, the reports of the audits that are conducted by third-party agencies against these stringent controls, and also documenting their commitments in the contracts that they sign with you. So these are all sort of the questions that as lawyers we should be asking in the absence of, you know, regulation, say, in the Indian market. But it's only a matter of time.
So self-regulation and accountability in the place of regulation, that's very interesting. Going to Kanchan from the data, big data industry. In the world of data analytics, it is really the collection and the processing of data and personal data on which big data thrives. When we're looking at the development of the data analytics industry, we read about differential privacy methods and differential privacy policies which the players are adopting. Can you tell us something about it? Can you tell us whether these differential privacy policies and methods are actually helping, and how is the industry looking at it?
The day-by-day companies are realizing the value and the potential of data. But considering that the Indian laws are not that developed and the limitations that are attached to how you can use and the purposes for which you can use data, companies do want to maximize on the potential that the data sets can offer to them. So companies these days are adopting techniques such as anonymization and several differential privacy techniques, which then help them to utilize this data to be able to service their customers better, make their products better. And I would say to a certain extent it does help companies because they get to learn a little more about the customer. And these differential privacy techniques actually help you to get closer to the customer by generating, you know, insights using anonymization techniques and learning a little more about how best they can position themselves to be able to market their products better, to be able to service their customers better without actually disclosing the identity of any individual. So, and whether it is being effective, it all depends on how robust these systems are, because the algorithms that are run to actually generate insights out of this data depends on how effective these algorithms are and to what extent the privacy is being maintained for each of these customers.
Thank you. So from non-regulated industries, I'd like to move to one of the most regulated places, which is the office, and talk about employee privacy. Supratim, there was a time when BYOD used to be a buzzword and it used to be disruptive in the offices. Today we've moved way beyond that. We have a situation where employers are tracking us through wearables, through apparently even through implantable chips. So can you talk to us about the ethics and the legality also of such practices in the workplace?
Right. So when we talk about ethics, let me give you statistics. So there are several statistics which have proved approximately 2.5 working hours every day, every employee is spent on cyber slacking, which is basically non-productive, non-work-related surfing during work hours. So I think ethics applies both ways. So it's not wrong to monitor. It has been, monitoring has been there since ever. But I think what is important here is to, understand the concept of, informed consent, which is now being spoken about a lot, of course, in the last session we just heard, how it is becoming redundant. But I am talking about a wider universe of, informed consent, where you explain to the employees what is being done, why it is being done, so that they are on the same side as you are. It's not adversarial, really. And that's how I think they appreciate what actions are being taken and become a part of it. So truly speaking, we are not only fighting menaces such as data pilferage or IP theft. We are also talking about productivity, for which these devices are being implemented. And it's quite scary, actually. What you said is, we were doing some work and we realized that since the year 2015, there are some institutions which are implanting chips, microchips, into the body of the employees. And you don't need a swipe card, really. That can be used for entry, exit. That can be used for buying smoothies in the premises. And so on and so forth. So one of my friends was asking that, these wearable devices are very, very, cool. What do you think could be a problem? I said, sick leaves could be a problem because your employer would know whether you're actually unwell or not. So the moot point here is that, blood glucose levels, whether you are stressed out on a particular day, all of this data would be available with your employer. The core question, therefore, from a legal standpoint is informed consent and also to what extent it is relevant for the purpose for which you're collecting. So if these two things are kept properly balanced, I believe it is a good move to have such tracking measures. Of course, you should not overdo it. Because in the past, some of these have been a little counterproductive. So we need to keep that in mind.
Thanks, Supratim. I'd like to move on to Blake, who's the non-lawyer and the technologist in the panel, and will surely provide us different perspective. And talk about data security. We've seen so many instances in the recent past about data hacks. We had the Verizon data leakage of phone information and phone logs, and we had an Anthem data leakage of medical information. Now, in this scenario, what advice would a technologist such as yourself give to your stakeholders in the company of how to process data and how to use data in an ethical and in a legal way?
Yeah. Great question. So I will try to look smart amongst all these really smart people, being a technologist that doesn't have a privacy or legal background. From a security standpoint, I think it's, to me, talking about data breaches, there's about one a day. You know, we just saw Equifax, you know, in the US that just happened, massive data breach, about every other citizen's data was compromised in the US. From a security perspective, the laws and physics around security of data are really kind of solved. I mean, it's really just down to statistics of encryption is encryption and it works, and there's a mathematical certainty of a probability that that can be decrypted. The problem with every sort of use of encryption is that the decryption keys are not properly stored and managed. You know, it's kind of, I don't know what the equivalent here is in India, but every home in the US, even though we all put locks on our doors and windows, there's probably the key under the mat, you know, the dummy rock by the door and things like that. So it's kind of the same thing with the way software works in all these companies, where the decryption key is right there in the app server sitting beside the database that has all the data encrypted. So independent of, you know, known mathematical models of here's how we encrypt and secure data, I think what's really important from the ethics, the privacy aspect, when you're looking at what can we do to help influence what companies are doing, I think it's really, you know, three things. First off, we have to start helping educate our very smart engineering technologists that are in these companies on the importance of distinguishing between can we do something versus should we do something. And, you know, often as engineers, and I have an engineering background myself, we love to just think of really cool things we could do, but it doesn't necessarily map to something we should do inside an organization. So I think just the general awareness of thinking about that inside a technology company is key. Additionally, companies really need to understand what they actually are doing. And you'd be amazed at the gaps that we see in the market where companies are just unaware of the information that they're even capturing, the type of processing that they're doing. And some of it comes from code that's put in by a really smart engineer that's trying to get better insights into how someone's using their application or tool, so they add a little piece of software. You know, that should be thought of as malware inside your code base. If you don't know what you're actually doing and capturing and documenting, you should consider that a virus inside your application. I think things like BYOD are another great point of where shadow IT has just taken the industry by storm, and companies don't really understand all the little apps, the file servers in the cloud that their company is using, where they've copied data over to it, and things like that. So being aware of what you actually are doing, what data you have, is key. You know, it'd be really bad to end up on the front page of the Wall Street Journal with a data breach for some information that was compromised, and you're not even using it to benefit your bottom line as a business. You just had it on the shelf and you weren't even processing it. And then the last thing I would say that's really important is transparency to your customers in the market of the way you respect data protection and the information that you have. I think a great example of this recently was Apple kind of announcing Face ID. And during the keynote where they talked about it, they talked about, you know, the security, here's how it works, here's how great it is and how beautiful it is and how secure we make the data, and it's secure. But they never really talked about what they did with that data and where it went. And you know, it was almost like an uproar within the next 24 hours from the internet of people kind of being very concerned, and now they immediately are kind of reacting and saying, we're going to publish a white paper that talks about how we're using this information, where it's stored, and things like that. So I think, you know, everyone gets that the world's not perfect, breaches will always happen, but if you are being very transparent as a company on here's what we do with your data, here's how we respect your personal information, and we really are always weighing the benefits over the risk, I think you'll get a lot of credibility, you know, if an incident does happen.
Thank you. I think, yes, transparency and engagement are quite key in these situations. Coming back to Kavitha, you know, when in the cloud services scenario, when the service that you're actually providing to your clients is really a movement of data seamlessly across borders, across countries, it is obvious that there will be some sort of influence and engagement by different governments, by lawmakers, and also by the users and the cloud service providers. Can you tell us a little bit about this engagement between different parts of the public and the private?
So in the context of security, you know, I'll give you examples that, you know, as Microsoft as a company and our philosophy on this. So we believe we are, as a cloud service provider, we are custodians of our customers' data, right? We can never be the owner of that data. The owner of the data is the one who's able to control the data. The distinction that I want us to understand is there's a perception in the market that once you've handed over your data to a cloud service provider, that you've lost control. If you've actually lost control of the data, then you're probably not, you know, engaging with the right kind of cloud technology. What as a customer you perhaps could worry about and ask relevant questions about are questions around, obviously, because you don't have access to the facilities that the cloud service provider runs, right? You don't have access to the infrastructure, but the data is still yours. And every cloud service provider should be able to give you that assurance that it is you who will determine how and who accesses that data, how that data is going to be used, for what purposes it will be used, and when you want to, you know, withdraw that data, it's and when you want to be able to do anything with that data is entirely in the hands of the customer. Now, that being the scenario, I think as members of the industry, it is incumbent on, you know, technology companies to stand up when governments have overreach, right? If when governments are actually trying to bypass traditional routes and are reaching out to this cloud service provider instead of actually reaching out to the owner of that data when they want access to certain data, it is absolutely imperative that the members of this industry need to stand up and say, one, have you employed due process in, you know, defining how you want have you employed due process in actually seeking that data? And is there an overreach? And when there is, we have to stand up and say no. And Microsoft has done this. We've actually challenged the US government not once, not twice, but four times, and successfully so. And I can give you a couple of examples where we fought for the right for our customers to know when governments have made requests for data. We believe it is absolutely critical to just, you know, supplement Blake's point. Transparency is key. Without transparency, customers will not trust us. And if you don't trust technology, customers will just simply not use it. So we stood up for the right to actually be transparent to our customers if the government ever sought their data. We think it's absolutely important to have that trust with our customers. And another landmark case where we fought the US government against a search warrant that a federal court actually issued against Microsoft in India because the US government wanted access to email of a non-American citizen where the data was actually resident on one of our data centers in Dublin. We resisted this. While they had issued a search warrant, so they had, well, technically followed due process, but we believe that that search warrant was absolutely incredulous. I mean, it was not properly issued because it was, again, overreach by the government and not employing the procedures that are already in place. Because our belief was that the US government should have gone straight to the Irish government using existing international mutual legal assistance treaties and then sought that data and not gone through the government. So we're proud of what we do in the industry because we're creating leadership in the industry and that has a cascading effect. And so when Apple stood up against the government in the light of, you know, those horrible terrorist shootings in San Bernardino in California, what the government was asking of Apple was, you know, really, would have completely compromised the very security that was protecting, or the security protocols that are protecting the data that is resident in everybody's iPhone device, right? So we stood up with the industry and actually put in an amicus curiae brief to say that what Apple was standing for was the right, you know, the right reasons. But you're right, there is a balance that we have to, as an industry, also create between, you know, what is
all of these issues around, you know, protecting our customers and their right to, you know, controlling their data, et cetera, and national security and public interest. So for instance, when there was that horrible terrorist attack that happened in December 2015 in Paris, the moment and they employed the right routes, the right legal routes to actually make the request. It took Microsoft 45 minutes to actually respond positively, handing over email information about those two terrorists in relation to those Paris attacks. So it is a hard challenge, but I think as we have a responsibility to our customers and to society to make sure that we stand up for the principles, not just what we say in our contracts and what we say publicly, but also, you know, abide by them when we're having tough conversations against parties like the government.
Thanks. I'd like to take this discussion a little further on ownership of data because that is so important. Sivaram, would you like to give your views on, how is the industry looking at who owns data and what kind of rights can we have over data that we collect from ordinary men and women on the street?
The data is owned by the data subject, right? Who is the owner of the data? The data holder or the data collector should have the right to use for the purpose for which it is taken. Like typically like a license, right? A software license, right? You get the rights through the license. But the question which there has been a lot of discussion today on this, the question is what happens to the metadata or the derived data? That's a question. See, that you should be allowing those agencies, data holders, to be using that data. But as Kanchan said, with anonymity and if there is a harm indicted to the data subject, the data holder should be accountable. Recently, I heard Mr. Nandan Nilangani had proposed a good model. He said, there is data at some place, and we should be, for the purposes, we should be able to use it. So he had said a model, the data subject would be at the center of this information sharing. Like, I go to a place, they ask me a whole lot of data, and I need to get some certificate. I give the consent to take it from wherever my data is held. I think Jio did it. We know, in 3 minutes, you get a handset and a connection. What you're doing is you give your right through biometric expression, consent, to take all the data in the Aadhaar. See, we don't know about the other things because the law hasn't come, so whether it'll be used only for the purpose, after the purpose is over, whether it'll be deleted, all that we don't know. But in my view, he talked about the consent part of it. As Stephen said, we need to have both. The consent part as well as the accountability part. If there is a harm indicted, there is a damage, it has to be indemnified. There is no other way. So both put together, I think one could address, but very, very clear, the data owns with the data subject.
Thank you. Speaking of Aadhaar, we would be remiss if we did not discuss the judgment, although other panels will be discussing it in detail. I do want to speak to Nappinai about one aspect of the privacy judgment on informational privacy, which the Supreme Court said is a facet of the right to privacy. In our online lives, you know, we give away a lot of our data without even knowing we're doing it, and the background to that is the terms and conditions and the privacy policies of various sites and apps will have a very innocuous consent language. Now, we have had very heated discussions about how consent may be redundant, it may be dying, or it may, you know, be replaced by other methods. Could you tell us whether consent is still relevant and whether you believe, you know, it's an evolving concept today?
Yes. In fact, Rakhi, it's interesting that this question ties into one of the questions that came up in the earlier session. I'd like to address it together. But before we go into that, I thought that one portion of the judgment, which I think is very reminiscent of what we are talking about today, would be nice to elicit here. If I could just read it out. I think this is from the portion where Justice Nariman has given this thing. He's extracting from Felicia Lamport's D privacy. and says, although we feel unknown, ignored as unrecorded blanks, take heart. Our vital selves are stored in giant data banks. Our childhoods and maturities, efficiently compiled, our stocks and insecurities, all permanently filed. Our tastes and our proclivities, in gross and in particular, our incomes, our activities, both extra and curricular. And such will be our happy state until the day we die, when we'll be snatched up by the great computer in the sky. I thought this was a fantastic way that they have started the whole discussion on information and data privacy. In fact, in my book, I have referred to it in terms of consent as that people today are happy, more happy to say, I agree than I do, right? We just go out there and click right on there and we have no time to pause. There is sufficient research which says every person has to read every single terms and conditions. We would need a lifetime. So therefore, when Stephen and others were talking in the earlier session about how consent is technically dead, they're not far off the mark. So to a large extent, today consent is more a formality or a mere action rather than being informed consent, as Shivra mentioned, or instructed consent, as I would put it. So when we're talking today about consent being essential, I would say that yes, it's not just consent, it is accountability and consent. And I'm going one step further here and saying responsibility. Because we are also talking about self-regulation here. And that self-regulation has to be a responsible self-regulation. And in doing this, I would like to focus on the question raised more on the aspect of liability. And I would like to tie in the earlier question on artificial intelligence also to this, because everything effectively flows in the same way. You know, the law, the first principles in terms of liability are going to flow through. And that's why I wanted to address the question that was raised earlier about whether conduct or the result decides the liability. I thought that was a fantastic question. Because I would like to digress slightly from what Stephen said about harm being a decisive factor with respect to liability. Now, whether it is artificial intelligence or consent, which we are talking about, and possible violation of privacy, the laws that have been evolving, especially in this world of I agrees, you know, the click wraps, is that whilst the contract is binding, it is legal, we cannot shy away from that, but we cannot be bound over to unconscionable or unreasonable terms. And in deciding that unconscionable or unreasonable terms, the decisions do not go into harm as a precondition. It is merely the violation of a right. So I'll give two examples in that. Two of the most shocking violations of privacy were that of the Kayla doll, where there is a global advisory for it to be recalled. Okay, and then the Vizio, the TV, television case. As far as Kayla is concerned, it was a very cute doll. Everybody around the world was happily buying it. It had a chat bot. So there was also this, you know, we all love our new toys, and here is a toy which is also a new toy, right? It's like a bonus. So everybody around the world was happy to buy it for their child. And then they found out that the chatbot was actually having conversations with the child, collecting information about the child, its habits. So when the Supreme Court is talking about us residing in the computer in the sky, it's not just us, it's not just our rights that we are signing away. We are doing it even of children. And this information that was being collected from the children was being used for marketing purposes. The issue that arose was that the same information which is residing in a server could very well become a victim to a hacking and can be misused against all those children whose data is being collected. So there was an advisory. One, there was a recall of the doll, and there have been advisories across the world for destroying the doll or to throw it away and not to continue using it. Where is the consent in this? Right? But to address the issue that you raised. The consent is not even implicit. It's an assumption that because you purchased the doll, you have agreed to use the chatbot, and therefore you're agreeing to anything and everything that the chatbot can do. Where is the harm here? The harm here is merely the violation of privacy of the child. It's not, you know, palpable harm in terms of somebody having misused it or having gone back and done something to a child, etc. So here, that's why I'm digressing from what Stephen said to say, it's not merely palpable harm. It is not damage to somebody through a violation that matters. It is that the violation of the right itself gives you that responsibility. The second case was of Vizio, which had a smart, super smart TV. You know, sometimes our gadgets think that they're smarter than us, and they probably are too most of the time. Like Sivaram said, we are becoming dumber when we rely more on gadgets, right? So what the TV did was, it was actually capturing expressions of people when they are watching, let's say, a movie or an advertisement, you know, and it was transmitting this back. Why do they need this data about you? They want it because, again, they want to know which advertisement works, which doesn't. So again, I think Kavitha raised a very important aspect of trust. Here is a clear violation of trust, because here is a TV which comes into your drawing room and is actually violating your privacy to the ultimate level. So again, here there is no palpable harm, except that it's a gross violation of your right. So if you look at the catena of judgments on liability, in terms of artificial intelligence, I was really zapped about how we have taken this forward in the similar way when Sivaram mentioned about how AI may not be able to distinguish between the dark skin to the light skin, etc. It's a very interesting thing that the German guidelines, which they have put down.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but we're actually running a little short.
Yeah, I'll just finish with this point on how the German guidelines say that, one, the AI is supposed to look at human versus machine, human versus animal, every time the human takes priority. But within humans, if you have to choose, it should not be based on any criteria. You know, so anyway, just taking the whole consent to liability forward, at every stage of liability, what the law states is, if you have a right, if there is a violation, if there is a breach, there will be a liability, irrespective of the fact that you may have waived it or signed it away. Secondly, the take it or leave it concept, saying that this is what my terms are. So forget about signing up itself. If you're saying that if you sign up, you're bound, otherwise don't sign up, that again is not an alternative that you're available with. Facebook, for instance, is facing it on this very basis about data privacy and trust.
Thank you so much. We did have a few more topics that we wanted the panelists to cover, but since I'm being told we only have about 5 minutes left, I would like 10. Okay, maybe we can you know, take a couple more questions. So, we'd like to talk about the impact of disruptive technologies in the practice of law. Supratim, if you could tell us how have disruptive technologies like AIs and Watson-powered lawyers, if you will, how have they impacted the practice of law?
Okay, so very quickly, in one of my recent lectures in a college, a young student came up and said that, would you really require freshers? Because I heard that machines are drafting the first drafts. So I said, yes, we will do higher things. You know, you guys need to think better on, say, some indemnity concept, how we can better carve, structure it. I was back in office, and there was some service provider who came to us and told us, we are having a particular software which will actually tell you if in your draft you have missed out on something. Maybe you should draft it in a particular manner, which you have missed out. If it's a buy-side share purchase agreement, please ensure that you have taken care of these five items. So I was zapped, and I was thinking my comment was maybe already redundant. So yes, so it is actually like in every sphere, AI is impacting the practice of law. In certain jurisdictions, the judges are being assisted with AI intelligence, and this has also been questioned, Sivaram. There is a very specific case on the point that you made. There was in Wisconsin, this guy was jailed for 6 years, and it was based on a AI software which said that he was a high-risk person. He wanted to challenge it, but unfortunately, that opportunity was not given. Later on, there were some news reports that that particular software, when when it was dealt with for a long period of time, there were a lot of issues in relation to convictions against blacks. So maybe the truth is not out, and the company has completely refuted it. But one cannot rule out that there is a pitfall attached to it. We need to be careful about it. Summarily stating, we cannot rule out human intervention completely. That will be putting us out of business. But yeah, it will be a symbiotic relationship. That's my gut feeling. Thank you.
I just want to give an example of what we're doing at the legal department in Microsoft. We actually use chatbots to sort of, we believe that artificial intelligence is, the purpose of artificial intelligence is to augment the work that humans do and help solve some of the most difficult societal economic problems of the world. The way it's solving it for us at Microsoft Legal is that we've done this ourselves. I mean, there are things that are difficult to do in chatbots, but there are also simpler things that we can do like ourselves. We don't need to be a coder to do it. We have colleagues of ours who have actually created chatbots to take care of their out-of-office replies, where standardized questions that come to lawyers, say in the context of Microsoft, questions around product marketing policies, questions around code of conduct and ethics policies. These are all there in text and policies. You don't have to be an incredibly smart lawyer to give responses to this. And the idea is that we want to elevate and do things that are a little bit more strategic. And as a community, as a legal community, we also have to be thinking in that direction. So these chatbots are actually used to respond to simple questions that are being asked by our business clients around these areas. And it's a really interesting way of handling the out of office so you can have a peaceful vacation.
Thank you, that's very interesting. I'd like to quickly discuss a little bit about best practices which companies are adopting in terms of an ethical and a legal use of technology. Kanchan, because ethics is kind of, it differs from culture to culture, it differs from business to business maybe, so how are you seeing companies respond to how ethical they should be in their use of technology, and have your views on that?
Yeah, so ethics definitely plays a very important part in any of your businesses. I would say that law is just a starting point, but one has to go beyond the letter and spirit, and ethics definitely has to play a very be on a higher pedestal when it comes to handling data, because we are looked upon as service providers, we are looked upon as data custodians. So there is a large amount of trust that the data subjects or our customers are placing on us when it comes to handing over their data to us. So it's important that there is a lot of transparency that is provided when it comes to data handling. So a lot of companies these days are when we do our contracts, we are actually trying to give that kind of confidence, be transparent by letting our customers know that how is it that we are going to utilize their data, how do we plan to secure it, what are the data security measures that are going to be adopted by the company to ensure that we do our best so that the data is not leaked. We have, there are certain companies, who go ahead and adopt some international standards going for certifications so that there are higher standards of security which are applied to data which is within our custody, because any data leakage can cause a lot of damage not only to the data subject but also to the reputation and the trust that the data subjects would repose on the data custodians.
Blake, as a technologist, would you like to talk about the best practices which companies can adopt?
Yeah, sure. I think these are all amazing discussions we've had and really kind of non-definitive answers to all these topics, right? They're very philosophical and things. What you know, in practice, I think all organizations have to start doing is, I like to kind of say, you can't replace smart people working on hard problems, but you still have to kind of operationalize doing certain things. What is new, I think, about these new regulations like GDPR from probably prior regulations and legislation is you can't just update your policy with your legal team in the company and kind of check it off and you're done. You actually have to change what you're doing, and you've got to enforce that change across the organization. So to us, you know, it's people, it's process, and it's tools. And what's really interesting about the era now, and this is what OneTrust specializes, is for privacy-specific programs, there are new types of technologies and tools to help you actually operationalize this. So how do I take consent? How do I take documenting what processing activities we're doing, what type of data is being processed by the organization, where are we crossing data transfers across data centers, and tying that process into the way we do contract management with vendors, tying it into you know doing code reviews as part of an integrated workflow within Jira with our development team as they build new features. All of those things, there's a just beautiful intersection of using new types of technologies to help you do that. So kind of bringing that back to life, I think it's how do you use a set of tools and new technologies to help automate things that you just never had to do at scale. It's tying in your existing teams of smart people, and it's getting kind of, you know, alignment with the CISO. I think the CISO takes a very vibrant role in privacy today because they need you to help kind of advocate inside a company to get all the sponsors aligned and the people actually executing on doing what you say you're doing.
Thank you so much. I'd like to open the floor for questions, if anyone would like to ask any of the panelists. Could we, is there a mic somewhere? If you could just introduce yourself and indicate who you're addressing the question to.
Hello, I'm Purnima here. I'm a lawyer from Bangalore. My question is essentially to the entire panel. In the light of the fact that Indian literacy levels are so low, how effective is this consent here in India? Because it's very important that most private companies are linking this Aadhaar. Again, I'm coming to the Aadhaar controversy, the data relating to Aadhaar. So what do you think that really the consent means in India? Because when you collect data in India, when a government collects data from private individuals, they think it's as good as we are giving the data to God, especially in the light of the people that the data is going to lower economic, coming from lower economic sections. So I think this is a very important question we have to address in India.
Would anyone in the panel like to address this?
Purnima, thank you for the question. In fact, I would take it one step further. It's not just about the illiterates that we are talking about. It's about digital illiteracy. Because you may be literate otherwise, you're still possibly digitally illiterate. So the concept of consent and why it is ineffective as the only alternative for data collection is not just because of literacy, but also because of a lack of application of mind in terms of the exercise of giving that consent. Secondly, it's also about the extent to which we are giving that consent without really reading or knowing about it. So I think what you've said about literacy is very important, not just from the government's perspective. And Aadhaar, I'm a strong opponent of Aadhaar, by the way. And I'm not going to get into the topic today because that will be another whole day of it. But one, consent as a process to consent as an informed consent becomes important. I think the only solution here will be digital literacy and understanding your rights and enforcing it. That may be the only solution.
I had a question. In part to the industry representatives and the lawyers. I am Anupama, by the way, and I'm a disputes lawyer in Bangalore. My question is, in light of this push to startup economy that India is focusing on, and really because startups are coming up with so many disruptive technologies of late, I'm wondering about where they fall on the spectrum, because we don't traditionally expect startups to have the same responsibility that larger industries display. Therefore, self-regulation and a sense of social and financial responsibility may not be easily expected of startups. On the other hand, because they're so reliant on external funding, they may be here today, they may be gone tomorrow. Therefore, practically, regulation and enforcement of strict compliance requirements, I don't know how practical and effective that will be, because they also have lean teams. They don't have compliance officers. They don't have large teams sitting and ensuring that you're complying with every law across the world. So I really don't understand where startups, you know, come fall in this broad spectrum, and how is it possible to practically regulate them?
Sure.
Okay, I think there's already a study which has happened in recent past, how the startups have actually compromised most of our vital data. So there is really a concern, and it's a valid one. As you are aware, after the Supreme Court decision, the government is actually putting together a law which will be soon in place. I think that will be a driving factor to understand its applicability and how it will regulate every player in the market, be it a startup, an established MNC, or the government. Point well taken. I think it's time that it's properly regulated.
So, I mean, in the traditional context of startups, they're creating products, right? I mean, they're creating products, or they're creating like disruptive services. The concept of privacy by design, therefore, in the context of what the Supreme Court's put out there, and the laws that will probably that are coming our way, that will probably look a lot like what the laws look like in Europe. Privacy by design becomes absolutely fundamental in the way startups are thinking about their own products. And it can't be something that's lopped on top of, certain, redundant architecture that which is just meant to sort of like tick a box. It actually has to be built into every feature, into the architecture of the product itself. And so this, the defense of, oh, we don't have enough people to actually sort of oversee this stuff is redundant. I mean, most startups are actually building their applications and their services and their products on the cloud, and actually liaisoning or tying their products in on top of the right cloud stack becomes important, because a lot of the time, these issues around can you create controls and can you create mechanisms in your products and services that will enable all of these consent requirements, that will enable all of these rights of end users in the context of privacy, is something that can be addressed in the context of the cloud itself. Because if you're with the right cloud service provider, they will be compliant off the shelf, essentially. So you have to think of this not just as a response in terms of, do I have enough people overseeing, but do I also have I tied up with the right technologies, and have I tied up with the right service providers who can enable me to comply?
Yeah, and just to kind of extend on that, just from a technology perspective, I think to get on the same point, software today and startups don't so much build new software as it is that they assemble existing components together to some new use case. So that's where I think we are going to see technology move from, you're not building, front-end JavaScript and things like that anymore. Those components now have privacy by design built in. The cloud stack has all these privacy frameworks built into it. And it just will help the industry holistically mature across the board, not only for startups.
One other place where you have startups working are apps. So the app store, for instance, would have to take responsibility also. And finally, I think it all boils down again to enforcement. If you're able to show that people who have violated laws or regulations have been penalized, that will rein them in, because all the money they are saving by not doing all this and claiming they don't have the infrastructure is going to end up closing the startup itself if they don't start right.
Thank you. Do we have any more questions? One question,
one last,
I think.
One last.
I just have a question in terms of artificial home devices, and I think you mentioned about the example that you gave, that just because you buy a device doesn't mean you are subscribing to the fact that you are okay to share your information. So clearly buying the device is not a good enough consent. We spoke about digital literacy, so arguably just kind of agreeing to the terms and conditions is also not a good enough consent. So I would actually like to know your views on what do you think would constitute sufficient consent, especially in the context of artificial home devices or artificial devices like a Google Home or a Facebook Jarvis that we are only going to see increase in the coming days.
Absolutely. I think the threshold level ought to be a practical threshold, of not just like she said, ticking the boxes, not just about signing off or waiving away our rights, etc., but of actually understanding what a device can do. I think Supratim mentioned earlier also about things like Fitbits and health devices. He mentioned it in the context of employers, but let's take it forward to even the context of the companies which are collecting all this data. How many of us really are even aware of the fact that all this data is being collected by somebody and being analyzed and utilized for marketing? So the combining all the things which we have discussed, I would say the digital literacy and threshold level for liability, that not just what I would want, but what a lot of cases that have evolved in this field give an indication of, is of consumers knowing what a product can do. What is it actually collecting? Because the rule, that if you're getting something for free, then you're the product. If you're buying something, then are you still the product? What is it that you're giving away as that product, right? So, and also finally, when we come to data protection laws, it has to be at a level where it is capable of being enforced. Already, even with respect to the old EUDP provisions, and the upcoming GDPR, what I'm hearing is that EU is feeling saturated with respect to data protection. So are we going to do an overkill in data protection in the name of privacy is another issue we'll have to balance out. So we have to balance out one, awareness and knowledge of the consumer to what they are signing away or what they are allowing to come into their homes or offices, where, or into the, has become part of their lives. And to what extent are they willing to give it away? Knowingly, consciously. I would say that's the threshold that one should probably hope for.
30 seconds, because I couldn't help but jump on. You wouldn't buy, an Amazon Echo if you didn't want it to serve certain purposes, right? Like, I want to get up in the morning and say, Alexa, play me my favorite Sunday music. Why is it able to do that and actually play my absolute favorite Sunday music is because it has studied my patterns, and to be able to study my patterns and all of the algorithms in the background that's doing that, I have to give it consent. So you're not going to buy, so I want to move away from, this fear of not knowing what you're doing, right? I mean, if you don't understand that, unless you're allowing, software to understand who you are, it won't serve the purpose that you want it to serve. And it's really that simple.
I'm glad you mentioned Amazon Echo. I'm so just going to take 1 second just to close this loop out. I promise 1 second. So in Arizona, the police asked Amazon to part with information about conversations that a person who was accused of, meaning who was suspected of murder, of, around the time when the murder happened, they wanted the conversations that Amazon Echo could possibly have recorded at that point of time. So now Amazon refused on the ground that a purchaser of Amazon Echo has a reasonable expectation of privacy of that content which it is recording, and that therefore that reasonable expectation should not be violated. So I thought I would just add on, because you mentioned Amazon Echo.
That's right.
Yes, yes. But the bottom line is, again, like, that's why I said that it's also the consumer's awareness and willingness to part. I would give another example of location services, right? So what are we willing to part with, and to what extent are we allowing even the data? See, merely because we have parted with the data doesn't mean we have agreed that it can be used in any which way. So it is both. What have we willing to part with, and what have we willing for that data to be used for?
Thank you so much, and I think that's all we have time for. I'd like to, you know, we've had very interesting discussions and very interesting perspectives were brought out. I'd like to thank each of the panelists for their contribution and the audience as well. Thank you.
A very lovely session indeed. Actually, I'm very happy that before disruptive technologies took over, we all had a childhood. This reminds me of a small joke that I came across somewhere, that I changed my password to INCORRECT, incorrect. I changed my password to incorrect, so whenever I forget what it is, the computer will immediately say, your password is incorrect. So these days of artificial intelligence and computing, we have something, life is all not that bad. You know, after so much of food for thought about disruptive technologies, we're going to disrupt your normal thinking further. There's some fabulous Indian and Oriental food that is waiting for all of you. And if there's somebody who's standing between you and the food, it is me. So I'm also going to stop here. But not before calling Nirupama on stage. Can we have Nirupama Nag? Madam, can we have you on stage, please? She's from Aspect Technology. I request her to hand over small mementos to the wonderful panelists. And also one thing, Nappinai has agreed to give away one book as a raffle to the delegates in the evening. So before the beer reception takes over, we'll do that. Thank you, Nappinai, for this.
My pleasure. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings an end to the pre-lunch sessions of the day. I wish you a very good intense networking and lunch session. Bon appetit. So we reassemble in the next 3/4 of an hour. Kindly be back by 1:30. Thank you very much. Please remember to take away your mobile phones and your gadgets with you. Do not leave them unattended. Thank you very much. For all the delegates, kindly take your seats, please. We'll be starting the sessions very soon. Thank you. And I have pleasure in getting you connected to our new set of panelists. We're about to commence the session 4 of today's conference, which is the interface of data protection and competition laws. My honor to call on stage the moderator, the session moderator, Ms. Gowree Gokhale. Thank you, Gowree. She is partner at Nishith Desai Associates. I also call on stage Mr. Pandurang Acharya, General Manager Legal at Swiggy. Pandurang, can we have you on stage, please? Madam NS Nappinai has consented to join this panel. Thank you very much for filling in place of the other GC gentleman who could not make it, unfortunately, due to a missed flight. Pandurang, can we have you on stage, please? Thank you so much. And Mr. Pranav Mehra is on the way. As soon as the gentleman is in, I will usher him on stage. Mr. Pranav Mehra, Principal Legal Counsel at Snapdeal. So I think all in all, it makes a very interesting panel, short, crisper set of panelists. So that gives more time, actually, to every panelist. So here goes your 1 hour of fame. Interface of data protection and competition laws. Thank you very much. Over to you, Gowree.
Thanks. Good afternoon. When I was just reading one research paper on how the data monopolies are getting created and the discussion whether they are indeed data monopolies, etc. Within a couple of days of reading that paper, I got a call from my ex-colleagues Rakhi, who was here before, and Aditi, that this is the topic. And I said, see, I don't claim to be any expert on this topic, but because I've just read the paper, I'm really tempted. So I'm going to accept it. So I accept it as a challenge. When I was doing my master's, my second year, I was debating which topic to take because I had very little time to prepare. I said, okay, I looked at the entire list. I said, hey, consumer protection law seems great because it will take little time to sort of just quickly study. Little did I know that consumer protection is going to be the basis of all that we are going to discuss henceforth, when I took up IP, when I took up competition law, everything goes back to the consumer, and of course the data privacy. Everything goes back to the consumer protection, and that is what we have been discussing, from the panel since morning. So this interesting topic on competition law and data protection, and of course not to forget the data privacy issues, what we plan to do today is sort of create a debate, because none of these are settled issues. Right? How, whether a competition regulator should look at the privacy consideration? Is data monopoly really a monopoly? Are consumers really getting affected in the context, not so much on data privacy, but otherwise in the context of competition law? All these are completely open-ended questions. I was also reading a paper by OECD. This paper is very recent. I think 1 year is no longer recent, right? So, okay, it's a 2016 paper. It's a 2016 paper, but I would recommend that all of us read that, because it gives a great perspective on how issues are developing. They of course don't give a lot of answers, they just raise the questions which we need to ponder upon. So let us look at, when you talk about competition law, just quick snapshot or from where to where, right? So I think when we had MRTP, we had concept of controls, right? That monopoly itself is bad, right? I know I'm going back to basics, but I think there is a necessity of that, because when you're discussing very complex subjects, often you sort of forget the basics. So just to reiterate, now we have the competition law, and world over, I think people are talking more about abuse of dominance, right? In the context of data, what does it mean? We'll come to that. Then of course you have vertical arrangements, horizontal arrangements. So again, data sharing. What does it mean, when you're talking about horizontal, vertical, who really are competitors for the purpose of cartel in the context of data? All these are very, very interesting questions, and the more I think about it, the more confused I myself become. So I'm going to sort of, require my co-panelists to sort of give their thoughts, so all of us sort of, have some good, thing to ponder over to see where are we going with all of this. So I think the other question, right, in the context of competition law, it's always talked about appreciable adverse effect, right, the AAE. And they go back to the concept of price and this and that. But when you have so many services being given for free, zero value services, right, so what do you mean by adverse effect in that context? Because there is no price. Right, so I'm going to raise all these questions one by one, but I thought I'll just sort of, because we are post-lunch, I want to first create some debate in your own mind so that all of us are alert and answer these questions to the extent we can. So let's look at various stakeholders that we have in the context of big data, and then moving on to the questions. When you talk about the context of big data, I think there is always a confusion that whether it's big data only in the context of digital world or could be also in the context of physical world, right? So let's start with the digital world. What do you have? Is you have platforms, the aggregators, you have sellers or content providers, you have infrastructure, the cloud providers, you have the public sectors, who is sitting on such a big data, and you have, of course, the consumers. So in that context, I just would love to have your thoughts on, in the context of when you talk about new business models, the startup, I think there was some discussion on the startups. What is more important? Is idea more important or data? And the reason I ask this question, because when you talk about competition law, where should be the focus be? Is idea really more important than the data? Your thoughts, please.
So certainly, idea is more important. I'll come to why idea is more important, but I would also want to give overview of how data has been so important all these years, because the data has been so data has been so important key factor for any organization were to come up with. There are a lot of industries now evolving because of the data that they had. Right, like you were saying on the Facebook kind of a case, this is a social site, but the largest data owner in the world. In a way, it's good. As a consumer, it is good as long as a service that you receive is free of cost. But certainly, yes, it is somebody who provides it cannot provide it making losses to. So he would certainly look at other possible means of generating income basis on that data. So now what crucial becomes particular to, I'm not largely talking about the entire data, I'm talking about personal data as a person if you were to work in, operate in a social media and all that stuff. Because data-wise, otherwise, it's a larger concept if you were to talk about. Yes, data is important, but idea is more important than data. Because without idea, you can't really have greater benefits could be derived out of data, right? So it's my take.
Sorry. How many of us start with a business idea thinking, oh, this is going to be very good to collect data, right? So the very concept of a business idea, the very concept of even startups or otherwise, or even an established business, getting into new avenues. I don't think, and I have not seen this trend at least, over the last 10 years when data has become the gold mine that it is today, where any business has started with just data in mind. It was one of those derivative products which became a lot more important or a lot more valuable than the original idea itself. It was by the way, it just happened.
It's a consequence rather than the starting point.
Yes, it is not the intent, it was not the outcome or the effect that the originators initially thought of. It just, I think somebody just had, again, it was again the idea rather than the data. Somebody had the brilliant idea that you have all this data here, why don't you do the analytics and see how best you can put it to use. So I would definitely say that ideas take primacy, but by context or its importance, data has overridden that.
Sure. How many of you believe that idea is more important than data? If you could have a quick poll. I think at least I can see maybe 40, 60.
I was beginning to worry. I thought everybody thought data was more important than the idea.
Sure. So I think in that context, when you talk about, and the reason I raise this question is because we are talking about competition law, right? When you talk about entry barriers, right? Because competition law also wonders whether any of the things or the market practices that are developing, whether it is creating entry barrier. So I think, Pandurang, over to you, because Swiggy is fairly new entrant in the context of the other biggies that you have out there. So whether you believe that data the others have vis-a-vis the new entrant, to what extent is it an entry barrier? How much time, lead time, they do have a lead But is it that difficult to sort of get that lead as, not so much lead, but you know, sort of unlock that value? So what is the lead that you really need?
First, I would like to talk for companies who manage data. Data is very important, as you all know. And they collect data with your consent, blah, blah, blah stuff. Everyone knows about it. And they misuse, use a lot of things. There is, I mean, since the theme is also about regulating. So I would, it is self-regulation, which is very, very important for any organization. So we don't have an evolved law in India for now. It is also a duty of the in-house counsel or the compliance person to make sure that, you know, the business really don't divulge into misuse of data or to like use it for some other purpose than what is being received for. Because see, in the context of e-commerce, I would say, most of the data that is received only to provide better service to the consumer. And it really does, right? And while providing services, there are a lot of other stakeholders also involved. Take a concept of a marketplace. And marketplace, when an order is received, any which ways the data, details of the customer has to be like flowing to the seller, right? Seller has to know, only then he can raise an invoice and also pack the consignment. And then it has to be picked up by someone who's into a logistic business. The e-commerce itself doesn't do logistic, right? So somebody else, data is shared so that he could pick it up, pick up the goods, consignment, bring it, and there is a data managed, consignment managed to logistics, and then warehouses, and then reach to destination, and then it is further delivered to a last mile delivery. You may have local partners, or maybe like companies who does end-to-end logistics can be a better choice. But most of the time, because of the last mile churning that the business could see, it would be very difficult to have last mile delivery person stick to an organization for a long time. There are a lot of people. And now, therefore, data is being shared with multiple stakeholders to ensure that better service is provided. And also, what these companies could do with this data is to back-end, do a data mining. We call it big data. A lot of analyzation goes into data, right? With that data information, and also like if you were to like normally browse through or place order, continuously use a service, they will have an ability of assessing your preferences, right? Assessing your preferences will only like also a geographical location that you are where you live in, and the time period when you would like to place orders, what is that your requirement, right? And also like preferences and interest that you like, where you go, because when you were to log into your platform or any website, their bots will also monitor you, like, what is that you do along with that. And they will be short living, but they could see also that if you were to change to or switch to another website, right? So this is a lot of intelligence. Hey, Pranav. Sorry. Come in.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Me?
Just started, so we are at
still. I'd like to apologize to Vistara for delaying this entire thing for me and for the driver who had a new car, because he said I won't move more than 60. So, anyhow, let's start where you begin.
So, in that context, company mining data and producing better analytical skills onto customer preferences, it is beneficial to a consumer. As such, I would say it is like better to have a competition within the organization, maybe within the industries, to understand, give a targeted advertisements, and to make sure that your preferences are this, so that you have certain set of products and services offered. And more importantly, it will also help them, because of your behavior onto the stay on the platform, so that they also know, okay, there is some lags in terms of concluding the transaction. They can really help in bring in better idea as to like reduce the transaction time and all such. And there is a possibility of better services. Therefore, I would say that data is something which is very, very important for an organization. And I would not see as a criticality for a consumer, as long as data has been used for the purpose, not then other than like cross-selling or maybe like used for some other purpose than which has been granted. And on the competition entry barrier side, the question is very relevant. We could see there is very few e-commerce, especially on the marketplace side within India, who have been grown over a period of time. There is a lot of consolidation also happens. Like someone acquiring another company, like they wanted to roll out a fashion division, but they would rather prefer to acquire a fashion company. So that their vertical for fashions is immediately increased. And ideally, that also brings in value for that particular company which is now being acquired. Under my statement is the users, right? So nobody talks about the user. There is no valuation as such for the users. But we talk about GMVs, we talk about the inventory, expansion, business, all that. But yes, that is something which is important. At the same time, can it create a barrier to a new entrant? To some extent, yes, it is. Because you don't have an intelligence of customer preferences. You don't know, you can't plan things. If I were to say, it may be like sound very, very typical, but yes, if assume particularly Delhiites buying more iPhones. So I would, as a company, would prefer to store more iPhones in Delhi so that my logistic cost is reduced. Ultimately, I benefit the customer, but I have that intelligence. But whereas new entrant will have that, no, we will not have that. So entry barrier to an extent, yes, there is. But at the same time, we'll have to look at the customer. Someone has to they have to create their own data bank, yes, which is not easily available. Yes, they'll have to do it. Otherwise, they'll have to work with somebody who has data. Therefore, more often you can see that, mergers and somebody who has data will also think, like your first question was like whether data is important, idea important. Somebody has data will also have an idea, and so that he can really monetize that data.
Sure. So, Pranav, your thoughts on we spoke about entry barriers in the context of, availability of the data, right? And I think, Pandurang has given his thoughts. But when you talk about the data that you already have, unlocking that value, and doing certain further tie-ups, let's keep the privacy and the consent issues aside for a bit, because let there be an assumption here that those consents have been taken, right? But what are the different types of business models that are evolving? And the reason I ask this is because I now want to move on to the identification of the market itself in the context of competition law, right? Because today what is happening is you have an online and offline. I would want to give some interesting examples. I was watching the other day on television. Some of you may be aware of Nykaa website, which sort of started as an aggregator for the cosmetic products. And then now they are thinking about, the actual brick and mortar stores to support that online business, right? So you are seeing, I think even Lenskart was such an example. So you do see the need where, somebody started locally sort of more like a brick and mortar, suddenly now, we had a couple of clients saying that, no, actually I want to push my brick and mortar to online. So they wanted sort of to discuss that. So when you have this kind of an interface, I think Snapdeal, you also had a particular case which I remember on the online platform being just one of the platforms of distribution and not the market in itself, right? Hmm. So in that context, your thoughts on how are we looking at a market if you have to determine, because everything in the competition law context goes back to the market, whether it is geographic, or a product market. So your thoughts on how in the current scheme of things, how do you determine the market? Especially in the context of data.
Thank you so much. I think that's a relevant question given the amount of discussion that would have already happened over privacy and data protection. I'll come on to determination of market later, but let me start with whether data itself can be an entry barrier. And we always think whether entry barriers are barriers enough to probably have companies to make a decision whether they want to enter into a market or not. But in fact, if you speak to people, founders and CEOs, they're also thinking of exit barriers because they don't want to enter into a business which they can't exit, especially in India. So whether data can also be an exit barrier, and storage of data is expensive given the amount and given the type of data. If financial data, credit card data, very, very expensive. Personal sensitive data, very expensive. Other data, not so expensive. Whether a business model would want to have that kind of costing to save that data. Second, are we looking at, is data storage enough? Because there is a lot of cost on data processing. You have to make sense of data. If I'm Swiggy and I know who lives where, I have a lot of databases of people in a colony who order butter chicken, correct? But what sense does it make for something like Swiggy, who's an intermediary? Maybe for a seller it makes sense, but for an intermediary it may not. So the kind of processing and analytics is another market for data, which, and then you will realize that within data there are 10 markets. Data collection is one market, data storage is another market, data processing is market, data analytics is market, monetization of data is one market, selling that data, procuring that data, everything is market. There are firms which do market research, and they don't go household, they buy data. And this data can be either encrypted or not so encrypted. And then you'll have to spend again on getting it, you know, unencrypted. Therefore, at every stage, the market differs in terms of data. And when you're looking at an abuse of dominant case or an anti-competitive agreement between two entities, you need to see whether they are in the same line of business, whether they are in fact, not just only storing data, but also doing something complementary. And data has to be good enough to either supplement another set of data, which will make more sense, like you have Aadhaar card with credit card, bank accounts, and then you have PAN numbers, or colliding into one, giving an identity of one person. If not, then that data doesn't make sense. If I only shop through Snapdeal and I only bought a watch, that data is not good enough. You need to see the whole atmosphere of that data. And then why is data so important, we need to ask. What will happen if data is not there? Your maybe target-based ads may not happen at all. Your search engine optimization will not happen. Companies who are excelling in search will not know what to deliver it to you. Companies will not know what time of the year people would want to fly. Companies would not know what time of the year you would want certain products. Basically, on Navratris, you would need some puja thalis. On Dushara, you will need Ravan, you know, that kind of data helps. And especially in India, because every few kilometers, every city has its own data, which is not comparable to any other city. Therefore, in terms of competition law, you need to see whether a company owns enough data to abuse it. Okay. And if two companies are merging, whether that company will be huge enough to make the worst out of that. Now you need to see whether that will affect the competitor of that company or whether the consumers. And if it is a consumer, whether that will come in under the purview of competition law or whether that will be a consumer case. I mean, that's a question which we don't know yet.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think I just, you know, Nappinai, I know you want to add, but I just want to give one perspective which I want you to address as well. I think that was a very interesting thing. You know, it may appear simple, but the fact, the way you broke down the market, right, that is very interesting for a perspective of what is a product market, right? Because it's a product and service after all, right? So that's service market. Now, the point that you have raised, Nappinai, I would want you to address that as well as the question I'm raising. Because if you see the way Indian law developed, you had MRTP and you had Consumer Protection Act. Earlier, both the enactments had something concept of unfair trade practice. When competition law came in, they said that, you know, in any case, unfair trade practice is already being addressed under the Consumer Protection Act. and therefore let's drop it from the MRTP, right? So you don't have that provision under competition law anymore. However, now what happens is the consumers may not, there are consumers out there, they may not realize that they all are suffering as a particular unfair trade competition. But if you see now under the Consumer Protection Act, insofar as consumer is concerned, who can raise a complaint? It is only the consumer, a consumer organization, state or central government. A competitor technically cannot raise a complaint under the Consumer Protection Act. So you do have that gap where unless some NGO suddenly realizes that these, you know, this unfair trade practice is being, you know, sort of carried out vis-a-vis the consumer, there is nobody else. Earlier under MRTP, I remember there were cases where one competitor would point out an unfair competition, though not affecting him directly, but vis-a-vis the consumer. So, you know, if you can just address these two points, and what is the solution for that?
Yeah, I think we've kind of jumped that one point in terms of the data as an entry barrier. But, you know, I thought I could go back to that to explain the basics again. You've already captured a lot of it on that. But just to add to what you said about MRTP to now, or even generally competition laws, and how it has been redefined in today's world, right? And especially when we address it to data. What was it that created, you know, what was considered as unfair competition or a dominant position abuse under MRTP or today? We won't talk about the specifics about under MRTP. Let's just go directly to the Competition Act now. And what is it that is likely to impact what both of them were talking about as data, and whether it's really going to be to affect entry barrier. You had, you know, certain basic typical criteria which you would look at to see whether it is a monopoly or not. So you would look at pricing as a factor. You would see whether that product has been tied in so much that there is no other alternative. So a clear monopoly that is in the hands of the seller, which is therefore going to impact the consumer. This is primarily how you would look at it. When you apply it to data, and I'm now focusing only on data or not on general e-commerce products or otherwise services. When you look at data as a product, one, there is no pricing today for data. We are giving it away for free. It may not be free always because there are businesses which are purchasing it. So your data, you may be giving it away free, but it is not necessarily always free. But when it is being sold, there is no monopoly in that sale. It is as available to Snapdeal as it is to Swiggy. Right? So therefore, again, there is no monopoly over there. There is another aspect with respect to monopoly, which is, you know, some product or a service being so limited in availability that if you create this monopoly, it is going to impact the consumer. At the end of the day, consumer is the king with all these laws, right? Now, is there a limited availability of data? There isn't. So when it comes to data as a barrier, when you look at it from the legal perspective, it is going to be very difficult to maintain it as a violation of dominant position when you talk about consumer protection, when you talk about the competition laws. As far as consumer protection is concerned, the tables are turned over there. There, the consumer's right is going to arise from whether his data has been violated, and by using that violation, whether he has been misled or misrepresented. You know, what you rightly pointed out, the unfair trade practice, whether use of his data to target him for, let's say, advertising. Such targeting, if it can be shown to be unfair trade practice, for all you know, the consumers may succeed in the Consumer Protection Act. So now to take that to the question that you raised, I think the delineation has been very correctly done in terms of splitting up the laws to say this is going to deal with the business aspect and this is going to deal with the consumers thing. And if you look at some of the case laws that have come up before the Competition Commission, you will see that it's already been raised. Flipkart has been hauled up. I'm sure Snapdeal has been. A lot of the e-commerce sites have been hauled up. Some of them not very successfully because the cases have been shot down. But Google has faced a penalty for abusing dominant position. And what are the cases that I'm talking about? Is it merely abusing dominant position between one business to the other? Or is it a dominant position which affects the consumer and therefore I am raising it? It has actually been predominantly the latter, and that was the issue which you raised. You know, of can a company take up an issue saying it may not affect me directly, but it is definitely going to impact the consumer. It's definitely going to impact pricing. It's definitely going to create a dominant position which is open for abuse or has already been abused. And those issues have already been raised. For instance, the Flipkart case was where they said that, you know, one particular product was given only to Flipkart for sale. They created, it was exclusivity and monopoly. The Competition Commission struck it down saying that that is an exclusivity which is for a site. It is not like the product itself has been blocked out. And here again, the issue was of consumer thing. Whereas the Google case was business to business, because that was on the AdWord search, where they said that if you you know, allow Google to do this AdWord search in the way they are doing, it is affecting my business. Because what was it doing? When you do a search for, let's say, Flipkart, it will give you ads for all the other e-commerce sites also on the site, provided they have signed up with Google. You know, so there it was a business-to-business case. So I would say that the delineation which has been done has actually ensured that there will not be multiplicity of proceedings or conflicting judgments. So here the consumer can go to the Consumer Protection Act where there is a clear violation of his rights, whether it is in delivery of the product simpliciter or data as a product and its violation, etc., and the businesses move to the.
I think you know what probably we could do.
I see a lot of young faces. Maybe they're not too much aware of how MRTP operated. I worked for a regulator, and I also dealt with MRTP pending cases from 91 till 2001. And it was very interesting. I started only with competition law. I had never imagined that I would end up doing MRTP, which is basically entirely different on how you, there's no economics built, there's only law. Law says if you have 50,000 tons of production, and if you even produce one more, you're monopolizing, and then you need to be shut down. So that kind of atmosphere was there. But you know, let's come back to where you started, the UTP. After the 86 Act, the Consumer Protection, and the MRTP was there from 1969. The 86 Act duplicated what MRTP was doing. Until 91, there were 5 years wherein both regulators were taking UTP cases. Now the difference lied, any company could go to MRTP, and only a consumer could go under a Consumer Protection Act. Under the 91, they said, no UTP, UTP only be dealt by Consumer Protection. Therefore, company had no other way to go to a regulator to say that I have been, you know, unfairly treated by another company. Then what happened? We wait for 8-10 years, basically. And then the Competition Commission is envisaged. Then we wait for another 5-6 years after, you know, CCI is being, you know, been dealt with Supreme Court, whether the, you know, who's going to be the judge and chairman, how many of them. And then we see whether UTP has been ever taken by CCI. No. CCI says UTP is basically consumer protection. Consumer protection says UTP under consumer protection is only for consumer. So then where does the business go? And then business has no way. So it goes under RTP, you know, restrictive trade practice. And making a case under an RTP under the MRTP law was very easy. You don't need to provide any evidence. You just say, there's been an RTP. DG, please investigate. DG had an authority to just start investigating without even asking the MRTP. This got changed in the CCI. DG had to ask the CCI. CCI only says, DG, please investigate, and then only. However, another point wherein data fits in. Under the Consumer Protection Act, if your data is misused, there is no case because there is only deficiency of service in which you can go under the Consumer Protection Act, correct? Now, if you have a data case, can you go to the CCI? Again, no, because it looks at market, not just single case. Now, where does the consumer go at all? Does it go to High Court? Some of the consumers have gone to High Court, wherein the Flipkart, Facebook and WhatsApp. WhatsApp says, your data will be shared by Facebook. High Court says, not until this date, only after this date if you have consented.
this is one of the cases where the user is most well-read. He knows what I'm accepting. Most of us, when accepting whoever has an iPhone, day before yesterday got an iOS 11 update. We were so happy that we got an update, we never looked at what was in the privacy terms and conditions. We just said, accept all, done, next, download, install. If you read through the privacy policy, it will say things which we will never want to agree. And this is the cases with most of the companies which takes consent of the data. And therein, you know, you have guidelines which are not so proper. In the West, there is a clear-cut thing going on whether consent should be there or whether
it should be right. A lot of consent-related issues just in the previous panel. Yeah.
Only on one aspect, if I could just come in. You know, there is a reason probably why RTP was opted for instead of UTP, which is instead of unfair trade practice, a restrictive trade practice. We do not want to go back to the world of MRTP.
Correct.
We do not want unfair to be a basis for stopping businesses from flourishing. We have moved away from that mindset.
Control, yeah.
So it's not about controlling. It is not about saying you should not get richer. It's okay if I'm not getting richer or if I'm still remaining poor. You know, it's about, you know, we don't want to become the crabs who will drag somebody down. It's only when it becomes restrictive, the exact question which you asked, you know, is it going to become an entry-level barrier? Only if it is something as monopolistic as to affect a business, they wanted to bring it in. So I would say there is a clear rationale to moving to the RTP kind of, you know, threshold rather than UTP.
I think just...
I just wanted to add, the very purpose of the Competition Act is to promote competition, right?
So healthy competition.
Yeah, healthy competition, yes. And I mean, there is nothing healthy, but healthy competition, yes. What could be looked at would be like, is there any abuse of dominance? And there is any carteling, like you have, you know, carteling to cases, there are a lot of cases that you can go and look at in a carteling. So that ultimately abuse of dominance ends up into what, how it is affecting consumer, and carteling, how is it affecting consumer? So I would rather say that Consumer Protection Act has changed to a competition law. This is all to ultimately looking into consumer protection, right? So this is what happened.
So I think I'll come to the next question, but just one interesting, because we spoke so much about data privacy and consumer protection, you know, there was one case where they said that, you know, this is some promotional calls or whatever when you're answering, you know, there was a case which said the free call. So they said it is not a free call because you're getting something from the back end. Right now, here you're saying here it is your free services available. You are getting data in the back end, right? So even from a communication perspective, you know, that particular case, if you remember, and now this case, you know, there is so much value in the data. It is not the question of 2 rupee where there was a 2 rupee share of that 5 rupee versus, you know, what data you're sharing now, right? So I think somewhere these principles, you know, you have to go back to see what has happened in the past and how the principles, those principles have to be applied in the context of data. It is a tough task, but somewhere you need to sort of go back and revisit those. And in that context, I just want to now raise a question for you. When you're looking at, say, you know, when you go back to section 3.4, I'm not coming to mergers yet, that's going to be the next question. But when you see, you know, section 3, which is, you know, the horizontal and vertical agreements under the Competition Act, and 4 is the abuse of dominance, right? In that context, I know that I'm revisiting that question, but when you're looking at all of that and the behavior, right? Ultimately, the competition watchdogs also see the behavior of the entities. So, you know, very interestingly, when you're talking about horizontal, right? It is the most complex things to unearth, as we have always, you know, said. So, you know, in the context, say for example, when you're talking about data monopolies and sharing of data and all of that, so in the 1990s, you had that airlines who were sharing that data and you had that investigation. Recently in 2015, you had Amazon's sellers trying to sort of, you know, share something among themselves. So I just want to read out, I was referring to this, you know, particular article. So in that context, you know, what the Assistant Attorney General said, we will not tolerate anti-competitive conduct, whether it occurs in a smoke-filled room. You always knew that, you know, when you when the cartels, you know, they always said that, you know, people go out for a smoke and then there was some, you know, discussion. So whether it is happening, you know, in a smoke-filled room or over the internet using complex pricing algorithms. So I want to come to that, because when you have that AI in the background, right, the AI is taking decisions. AI is deciding, you know, to share and whatnot, where, you know, that data is available, whether amongst competitors or whatever it may be, there is so much that is being done in the background. So when you talk about that, and you had earlier discussion as to how AI is, you know, talking to, I mean, sort of doing their own decision making. So who is liable in that context from a behavior? Because ultimately you go back to the behavior. So just some thoughts on that, because that's an interesting thing when you were talking about that, you know, it occurred to me that that's something to be looked into. How do you investigate and how do you unearth cartel in that context of data? Any thoughts?
Something to say in favor of, but
I was always an outstanding student, standing out. You were still inside the class.
No, we knew that already when you were late.
I think the discussion started with sharing data and then it came down to price data and then artificial intelligence in that order, correct? Mm. You shared what Attorney General said in one of the cases, that in a smoke-filled room, often, you know, after the smoke is gone, the prices are up. Now, under the Competition Act, if you are sharing price data, then of course it's a brilliant case of cartelization, but how you prove it is not something that we're discussing now. That comes to a question, whether only price data is the data which can lead to a cartel, or whether other types of data can also lead to. So that means every kind of sharing data within competitors makes you liable for a cartel. Exceptions are there, the shipping, there's a cartel, and airlines may want to share, but in airlines there have been studies like 5 times and nobody's been found in a cartel. Apart from that, even when, you know, there is some kind of natural calamity, the airline prices still go high, even without anybody of them conducting any kind of talk between themselves. Is that sharing of data or not? That's one question. Now, artificial intelligence. Let's come before artificial intelligence came in. We had market research organization that used to study how much is Inthol being sold for and how much I will probably price a Godrej soap for. And these companies within time became artificial intelligence, because these people are no more. The complexity of goods and services have risen and one man can't do the show, and therefore there are algorithms running in the background. But it is still continuing. There are offline models in developing countries and there are online models of sharing data, but it is happening. Whether this kind of data is anti-competitive in nature or not is something to be seen. Is price data of your competitor good enough data to be held for cartel? I don't think so. Until unless you collude, you speak, and similarly price, or price higher, or price lower, all three together, that could lead to a cartel. Just knowing the fact what your competitor is doing is not cartelization. Manufacturers do that, sellers do that, online agencies who are selling inventory-based models do that, everybody does that. We as buyers look at 3 websites, compare, we have a lot of data. How much is iPhone selling for in Flipkart, Paytm, Amazon, Snapdeal? The lowest I buy. I share that data with my sister, with my family, and my friends, and see whether. Now, is that a collusion? Not really. Why so? Because all of us are consumers, not competitors, and not in business of doing that. Comes to the point, when artificial intelligence is doing that pricing comparison,
They are giving inputs as well. I mean, it's
correct, not, correct. Yeah. So there is pricing comparison. There is a website which does pricing comparison. Doesn't tell you more than what is the price. Then there is pricing suggestion. And then there is price setting. All three are different markets. Correct. In each of the market, there could be competitors in artificial intelligence itself. Now, the question whether artificial intelligence itself will be someone who will be investigated, or whether it's maker or developer will be investigated, who's going to be liable or not, is a question that I think will come later on, even when the developed countries like, you know, some Google car or Tesla collide together and say, who's going to be liable for an algorithm that went wrong? And maybe then we will have some. Today, it's like quite future forward to even discuss, especially with respect to data, when we don't have laws of data protection, leave about competition laws dealing with data. I think that's the short point I wanted to make.
I think you wanted to add.
I just wanted to add what you said. So there is a lot of data, you know, scrapping happens online. So if I were to a marketplace, I would look at other marketplace, what is the price that they're selling at, so that they have an edge of selling the product. So I would see, then I would suggest my seller, okay, see, this product is sold at that price. So where will I get that intelligence? By the data scraping. I do data scraping not only for that, I also like do internally an analysis of data information, which is publicly available, which is not wrong. Is it fine, audible? Yeah. So therefore, as long as there is no, you know, talking to each other, curtailing, they're fixing price because they are doing something which is adversely affecting the, you know, competition, something which is important, as long as it is not done, I think it's absolutely fine to me.
Sure. So I think in the context of, you know, whatever we have discussed, I think what I want to understand is, you know, internationally we can see that there have been now some of the cases that have been raised in the context of, you know, data on the competition law side. India is still sort of not yet there, but from the kind of laissez-faire kind of a approach that, you know, one needs to take to support innovation, because you can't control things too soon. You need to let things develop. And there will be a particular point in time where, yes, there may be some control required looking at the behavior, because ultimately, as I said, you know, monopoly itself is not a bad thing. So I mean, at least my perception is we are yet not there, at least in the Indian context, you know, where the regulator really needs to intervene. So, you know, any thoughts on that? Because if all of us agree, then I'll move on to the next question.
Only
so, yeah.
On that earlier aspect, I just wanted to address one issue only on that AI versus thing. See, we are talking about cartels and we are talking about competition. There is a natural assumption then that the cartel is internalized within an organization and competition is anything external of that internalization. I think that would be very fallacious to assume that. There are instances of cartels of existing competitive businesses coming together and deciding, okay, we know we are all the known knowns in the business. Let's keep the known unknowns or the unknown unknowns out, you know? So there are cartelizations of that kind also. So whether it is physical acts or acts through artificial intelligence, you mentioned investigation and possible, enforcement. I thought that was a very interesting point which got missed out. I just wanted to address that. There is going to be a trail out there. You know, liability again. What happens invariably is most people seem to be reaching out to the low-hanging fruit, whichever is the easiest. Exactly. So what happens is sometimes the big fish get away because of that. And also the real issue probably gets lost in that. I personally feel that every single act leaves a trail. It's about one following the trail. Here it may not be a money trail as opposed to typical, violative cases. Here, but as you rightly pointed out, the conduct and the outcome, both are likely to give you an indication of whether this is an act which is driven by a cartel.
I think your point on outcome is extremely important, because see, ultimately you see what is the appreciable adverse effect on the market and all of that.
Exactly.
So in the data context, you know what Pandurang has been saying, that consumer really in fact benefits. Right, so whether if at all there is certain behavior which may appear in the context of a competitor to be an abusive behavior, when I say abusive in the sense that, you know, something that they are able to sort of capitalize with others are not able to capitalize basis data, but in the context of consumer, there is no real impact. So, you know, thoughts on that, Pranav? I think you have.
Yeah.
I think we started with what we call as behavior of an entity. Even the commission, the market, everybody looks at how is an entity behaving in a market, whether it's so there are two things, whether the entity is dominant or it's not dominant, and whether if it's dominant, whether it's abusing dominance, that's what we look now. A company which has data, now you need to understand just having that data and being dominant is not abusive. And maybe if it's not sharing data, whether that can be abusive, because sharing is now liable for Section 3 and abuse of dominance is Section 4 violation. So,
and then you have data protection laws. Mm.
Correct. Whatever kinds of protection now we have or not, that's another question altogether. So what does an incumbent entity has any role to share that data? Is it at a privileged position whether it should share data? And if it shares data, then what happens to data protection at all? So why should that dominant entity share data which he has, you know, sourced from a lot of time, processed, analyzed, stored, paid for it? And what happens when it shares? So these two questions together. And then you have, then Panduranga talked about data scrapping. Now, whether data scrapping itself is a violation of competition law or not, that we need to see from a competition angle. And if that is not a violation, then of course the CCI has no role to play.
Exactly.
Where will the CCI come when I start to abuse my dominant position in respect with data? Now, I need to also imagine what can a dominant entity, how will it abuse it? I am not sharing data, will that be abuse? Or am I sharing data, will that be abuse? How much data I am sharing or not sharing, will that be abuse? So we need to know if an abuse of dominant position happens, what is that company need to be doing? We just can't keep talking in the air. And if it's cartel, then what kind of data or what kind of benefits will the competitors have? We need to also see the market effect of sharing that data. It could be an insurance data. My insurance company talks with another insurance company, there's portability. Now this portability, this sharing of data, my telecom provider knows, my ISP knows what I have been doing, he tells to the another, there's a bill pending, he tells it to you, my bank talks to my credit card company, there is a lot of sharing
data,
of data,
absolutely.
Correct? Is that a cartelization? I mean, we need to know what kind of actual data sharing or not sharing will amount to a violation of competition law.
Absolutely, because in this context, when you talk about cartels, you know, cartel assumes that there are the competitions. But in the context of this complex businesses that you have today, who is a competitor itself is a big question mark, right? So to identify horizontal, who stands where today, it's not possible because you have so many business verticals within the businesses itself. And as you rightly said, within that, you know, the manner in which data, whether it is a collecting activity, whether it is sharing activity, whether it is monetization activity. So where do you stand in that context in a particular activity? I think it's getting into very complex, issues.
But, but there's one more problem here is that what is happening today is it's being left to the subjective satisfaction of the Competition Commission to decide when it is abuse of dominant position or not. I was thinking there is a third angle to what Pranav said, which is probably the only angle where you can definitively say probably abuse of dominant position, which would be that it's not about sharing of data or of thing, but of saying that I have the data and no one else should have the data.
Exactly.
So the non-sharing of it.
Vis-a-vis
yes.
The consumer,
yes.
Which in today's context is just, I don't think consumer will even realize that he has signed up exclusivity by the way.
Exactly. Yeah,
so. So I think let me come to, another interesting topic, which is the mergers. And in the context of what we saw in EU, right, when the Facebook and WhatsApp merger happened, and whether a competition regulator, when it is looking at when two entities are coming together and what they really are coming together for is data. And in that context, they saying that because you are going to violate the privacy of the individuals or, data protection laws, and therefore it is anti-competitive. It's sort of somewhere came to that level. So there is this, unsettled concept whether a competition regulator, if they cannot find faults in any other behavior, can tell that because you're violating the, this, and therefore there is an abuse and therefore a competition law issue. So your views on confusion between the privacy violation vis-a-vis the competition law, probably.
In fact, one of the earliest quotes on this was when the German antitrust agency talked about how they felt that they were deeply convinced that privacy was a competition issue. I don't think many people even realized or thought about privacy as a competition issue until these larger debates came up. Again, Germany again has taken up the Facebook and merger with WhatsApp, and it has taken it up as a competition issue. Now, today we have the Indian Supreme Court deciding it as a data privacy issue. You have the EU, which has already decided it as a data privacy issue and a violation. And you now have Competition Commission trying to decide whether it's a Competition Commission violation. When you look at the conspectus of this, what was the rationale behind even saying this? Even with respect to data violation or Competition Commission is, on one hand, they say that unlike certain other, so they're not talking about data here. They're not talking directly about privacy. They're talking about social media as a domain and Facebook as a product or a service here. And they're saying that it is not like Facebook or WhatsApp are easily replaceable. It is not like you have alternatives. So this is the same rationale which is applied even when they say that there is an unfair practice of insisting that a person who has been using this service must sign up the new privacy policy. Otherwise, they have the option of getting out. You know, the Hobson's choice issue, which is being debated before the Supreme Court also, is it's a take it or leave it policy. You know, you have the option to get out of WhatsApp, so why are you complaining? But the law is already settled in this in the US, where it says that a Hobson's choice contract, particularly where you have already created some level of dependence on your domain, and you have also created a sort of monopoly in the sense of what they say is, if Facebook has created a platform where they say, oh, bring all your friends together, bring all your family together, you've already brought them together. And to say, okay, now that you've brought everybody together, now that you have gotten used to coming to Facebook every day, Supratim mentioned about the, you know, the
2.5 hours.
Yes, 2.5 hours, right? So those 2.5 hours are being spent on this Facebook, connecting with family and friends. Once that dependence has been created, and then you give a Hobson's choice saying, no, sorry, now you take it or leave it, or you accept whatever I say, it is unfair. And therefore, the data protection angle. Now, what is in the Competition Commission angle also is similar, that you have created an assumed monopoly and you are now using the dominant position to insist. So here again, this was what I mentioned earlier,
yeah,
that the Competition Commission can be brought into use to protect consumer rights as much as business rights, even where a business entity feels it is being abused.
Sure, I think the other argument for this, I was reading something, they said that it amounts to a change of a product description, because you bought, or when you signed up, there was a certain product and now you're varying the terms of the product, right? So that's another good...
Yeah. And you know, I loved your reference to first principles, because with law, I personally feel we always have to go back to first principles. Then the law evolves in a natural curve,
right,
as opposed to a contrived one. You know, so when we go to first principles about contract formation and vesting of rights, here is a situation where the contract is already enacted. It has been acted upon merely and merely because you're improving a product doesn't give you a right to take away vested rights. And therefore, it has to go...
I think our time is getting up, but I want to throw a last question, and that is in the context of Aadhaar. It's a very controversial topic, I know. So I'm not getting into too much of Aadhaar as a question, but more of that the government today, we talked about non-state actors, you know, competition and whatnot, but in all the countries today, government is the biggest holder of data. And there have been certain discussions as to how that data analytics can be actually used with the private parties, and that is, you know, in so in the context of Aadhaar, we will know in November what where we are going in the context of fundamental right, because that's a very high threshold. But I think there are certain discussions where a public-private partnership in the context of data creating healthy competition. And one example that they were giving is that, this is last question, so we can then stop. Last question. So, you know, the question that was being raised that today, suppose a car operator is willing to share, a sort of taxi operator is willing to share a traffic data with the government so that the government can benefit to manage traffic better, but has a fear that a competitor then will have access because that becomes in the hands of the of a public regulator. So, you know, these are interesting questions. I know we don't have too many answers, but any quick thoughts, then probably our time is up already.
I think I'll go back, but the car. So you have a car driver who drives and he shares the data with the government. The government then probably licenses it to a competitor. All right, I mean, competition issue, not really, maybe more like a data protection privacy issue. What if you have a satellite which actually holds your GPS and you do not give a license to anybody but you? So you have a company which has a taxi riding service, has an exclusive contract with a satellite operator who has a GPS. No other can enter into that market unless you have a GPS. That's a good case for a CCI to look, yeah. not the prior case, correct? Then you have the German authority, which has gone overboard with saying, because you have a lot of data and you violated data protection, so you're violative of the Competition Act. That's what merely is the entire judgment. That will not be upheld in India at all. You have confusion with privacy and competition law. Of course you will, because nobody understood privacy until the judgment came in. It's been 8 years, nobody still understands how Competition Commission works. So there will be confusion. And then the last, the exclusivity, confidentiality obligation and competition law. You have exclusive contracts, then you sign an NDA, and then you have a competition law violation. Whether it's a violation at all, I mean, we enter into an NDAs all the time, we have exclusive contracts all the time. If not, then who will protect our business? Is that a violation? I mean, really, Pandurang.
No, as long as it's not adversely affecting the competition, it's not a problem. Most importantly, NDAs to protect your own ideas so that those confidential informations are protected. And then exclusivity cases is not that, you know, we will have to see, I mean, how it is, whether it is.
Again, going dominance. Back to the effect, right?
Yeah, this oral effect, you know, therefore, I don't see exclusivity is absolutely from Mohit Manglani case. Flipkart wala. So mobile phone itself is not a market, and e-commerce, electronic commerce itself is not a market. So relevant market is something which has to be looked at in a competition perspective, and therefore it's very difficult, very very difficult to like, you may tend to feel like, are you cheating over? I mean, it's not that. So Competition Commission really not an answer for such kind of a.
In fact, they did say that.
I'm not even going to get into the question that you raised about Aadhaar, because we can take the rest of the day and Devi will throw us out. But, there he is. He's marking his presence over there. I just wanted to say that, you know, unlike us giving away data to commercial entities, or even if with them taking it away, you already are seeing the impact of legal precedents that are coming out on that. So there is a remedy available. Unlike all this, if the government itself is going to be that sponge which is going to keep taking away all your information, where you have nowhere to hide, nowhere to run, and you know they know it all, I think it's a very dangerous situation that they are putting us in. One, fundamentally, my fundamental issue over there is that, you know, when I sign a social contract with my government, as opposed to some other government, because one of the issues that have been raised is, oh, you give away your biometrics for visa, why shouldn't you give it to me? That's because I choose to visit that country, but I didn't choose to be born here, I am a citizen here. So once I have given you this right to say you can govern over me provided it is for my benefit, you cannot take the stand that just because you share it everywhere else, I am entitled to insist that you should share it with me. So I'm going to stop with that on
no,
the
I
other.
I think the reason I want to bring it back to competition and maybe a couple of questions is because, you know, there has been this thought process that because government is sitting on such a big data, whether there could be competition law issues there because they themselves are sitting on the data. But when you look at in the context of privacy, you know, that's not going to really go anywhere, you know, with the monetization of the data.
And we have enough judgments which talk about how governments, when they are acting in a commercial space, are no longer having the privileges of government. But with the other data in hand, they are bound to have a dominant position there.
I don't know whether we have time for one or two questions, or I think maybe during coffee break,
okay,
we could have that question.
We can take rest of the questions offline, please.
Buying through online, okay, for whatever, for my accounting or any person, if I request to add the GSTN number to be included in the commercials, it is on Amazon, it's asking for the even GSTN login, name, password, everything about the GSTN site. This really, it is a big threat, I think. Somebody has to take a look into that actually. But why, if I'm buying from Amazon or any online portal, why they need my GSTN credential for that?
I would say this is not a new threat. This was there since we born and before we born. Government had ration cards then, right? And sales tax registration was then. GST, because GST, you were to like have been threatened, okay, GST, every data is with GST, you know, government, third party is managing. It's something which is, right?
No, no, I think he's talking about the input-output.
I'm not talking about that data part. I'm not talking about that. Why online portal?
We'll take it offline. We'll take it offline. I think we're short of time. We'll take it offline.
Because we're short of time. Thank you very much. And over to the next panel.
Before we move over to the next panel, I would like to call upon Ms. Bhavani Padmanabhan to hand over a small memento to all the panelists, please. And I take this opportunity to thank all the eminent dignitaries on the dais. A round of applause, please. Thank you, Ms. Bhavani. And a photograph with all the panelists.